is time for this week's AMA. So, to kick things off, first and foremost, I wanted to kick over to the friskiest of foxes, the current seeker of pants, to talk about duels.
Great, yeah. Hey guys. So Duels was launched last night, and it was really close to launching for a long time, but we just had to make sure all those little things were ironed out. There was a lot of some new like interfaces added to the front end, things like the leaderboard for champions, which will play a big role in who will get those crowns at the end of the season. Also just equipment in general, having it be supported from the dual rank claim smart contract, which up until now has just supported ERC-20 tokens. So there is a lot of efforts on all those fronts on how is the best way to do that. So those things, and then we sort of added in a way to trade in medals for the champion mode. And that was just sort of a way to try to make it have more of a reason for you to keep on trying to become champion. After you earn those original medals, there's a chance that some of them are going to be higher value or higher rarity. And so if you want another chance at trying to roll those dice and getting those, you can actually trade in the ones you don't want in order to get another chance at receiving higher ones on the next time you become a champion in that lobby. So that was fun, and I think it's going to be really interesting to see over the course of the season what impact that has on the amount of people that are doing those challenges and how often those are going to change hands, because I think it's going to be a lot more competition this season. Just because of those prizes and also the increase in the fees that the current sitting champion will get. So there was those things. It was a lot of fun to work on, a lot of fun to test, and there was a lot of testing involved with that. So huge shout out to Winston and our knights and also Mr. Zipper. I tried to do as much of the front end as I could this time around so that Beetle Dude could like really concentrate on the stuff he's doing for the hunts, which is also very exciting. Mr. Zipper came in sort of in the 11th hour and was like, okay, I'm going to take what you've done and I'm going to make it better and cleaner. And so he sort of like cleaned up a lot of that at the end too. So huge shout out to him. But yeah, it was just really a team effort. And there's already been a very good reception. I've heard a lot of good things about how it's smoother. There was a lot of optimizations made to the gas costs for like matchmaking and also for just dueling itself. Even though we added more complexity to it in terms of the equipment, we actually were able to eke out some additional savings there on gas. So I was really proud of that. And it's also more secure too, like the randomness is even more bulletproof than it was before. So really stoked about that front. What else to say for duels? Let's see. Yeah, I'll just continue to be monitoring it and see if there's any like issues that are found. I've seen a few like reports of some stuck matchmaking, so I'm currently looking into that. But the intent of this season is to make the matchmaking be more reliable and more smooth, especially at the higher levels, which we've had some troubles with in the past, just because there's not as many players that are up at those higher levels. But yeah, I'm excited about this one. I think it's going to be exciting and great, and stoked to see what everyone thinks of it. So feel free to shoot me any feedback you have in a DM or in the channel for duels, or write me a big long five pages from like the guild that I got this last season about what could be changed, and I'm always excited to read all those feedback. So thanks everyone.
Yeah, super exciting launch. There's so many new features for this season, so if you have not yet, highly recommend reading the Medium article that's in the announcements. because there's a lot of really cool stuff that Fox has been working hard on getting added. So really excited to see it come to fruition. Let's see. So next up, we have a surprise special guest with us today. We have Christian Peter up here on stage with us. And KP's up here because he will be joining the Kingdom Studios team as an operations specialist. He's going to be doing a lot of different things, wearing a lot of different hats, and contributing in a lot of different places. But we're really excited to have Christian with us and helping to, you know, continue building DFK and making it better and better. He's got a lot of skill sets that we think will be incredibly useful and complementary to our team, and just generally really excited. I maintain that we need him to pick a pseudonym now, just for consistency's sake, but that's okay. But yeah, all in all, just incredibly excited to have him coming in and helping us with what we're doing. So, Christian, anything you want to say?
Thanks, Bolon. Yeah, I'm super, super excited to be here after being in the community now for over 2 years and getting a chance to meet most of the guys that are up here on stage. I'm super, super excited to be in this opportunity with everyone. I mean, I've been creating content, as you know, for DFK for about 2 years now, and getting a chance to see everybody and meet people in person now at different events, it's great. It's just a super cool way to get involved with Kingdom Studios. I think that this is going to be just an amazing next couple of years, you know, after getting a chance to interview Fox and Dreamer and, you know, get a chance to meet everybody. And I'm super excited about what the future has. And I just can't wait to, you know, help the team grow. You know, if Fox needs something or Dreamer needs something or Beetle Dude's list needs to be reduced by a little bit, I'm here to help out in whatever capacity I possibly can. I want to be that chief growth officer that allows the team to expand and do things that otherwise couldn't have been done. And I know that behind the scenes, there's just a ton of stuff that's happening. And if you guys didn't know, Dreamer and Bolon were just on Doug Hype's Twitter spaces talking about DFK and all the growth that's going on and sharing it with everybody that's out there. But I love watching all of the amazing streams that you guys are doing out there. All the content that's get created by our community, the DFK family, is just super cool. And if you do create something, and you know, even if it's just a little video, share it on Twitter with me, DFK Today, or anybody that's out there. It's really cool to see the constant stream of content that's coming from all the amazing community members. And you know, I just think this is going to be the next bull run here in the near future, and I'm just super excited to be here with everyone. So I'll drop it back to you, Bolon.
Yeah. Excuse me. Really appreciate you. Appreciate everything you have done and looking forward to working closer and closer in the future. So yeah, super excited for that. Thank you for joining today as well. It makes the announcement way more fun to have you here with us. And so on that note, we are going to, actually, before we hop into questions, I'm going to try to remember to repeat this update at the end of the AMA, also in case anybody joins between now and then. But next week, so next week, Thursday, is Thanksgiving in the U.S., so we will probably not be having our AMA on Thursday. We are trying to determine whether we want to do it a little bit earlier in the week or, you know, potentially just not do one next week. So stay tuned for details on that. We're going to figure it out and let everybody know. But also our next AMA, whether that be next week or the following week, we are going to be moving to Twitter. So it will still be streamed to YouTube as well. And the current plan is we still want to use the AMA voiceless chat channel in Discord during the AMA because it's a lot of fun and allows for some great conversation. But we are going to be moving the next AMA into a Twitter space just to try to expand the accessibility and reach of our AMAs. So there'll still be the, you know, kind of encouragement to join Discord and able in order to participate in AMA voiceless chat, which is always a lot of fun. But that way, you know, more people on Twitter will be able to see it, see us, you know, as we're in it, all of our followers will see that we are in a space. So there's a really good reach opportunities from doing some Twitter spaces. So we're going to be giving that a shot. So in general, stay tuned for more details. We will get them to you, but just wanted to give that update while I had your attention. No, we will move it. Oh, go ahead, Fox.
No, I'm going to interrupt. Thank you, Bolon. I just wanted to say a huge like welcome to KP. And I think that, you know, it kind of reminds me of like Final Fantasy 6 or 3, if you guys are in America, where you had all these really cool characters in the game. And some of them, you can just like find certain ways to unlock them and they'll like join the team. And I feel like that sort of over here with KP and with others from our community that have joined over the last 2 years, you know, like it really is our community that is what makes this whole experiment so great. And, you know, we have so many amazing people out there, and I wouldn't be surprised to see other like really cool integrations and collaborations as we go. That's one of the things we're trying to do more of. And I'm just super stoked about that prospect. And I had the really cool chance to meet up with KP over in San Diego a few weeks back. And I was in town for a thing with my family. And it was just really, really cool to meet him in person. He's a great guy. He's got a lot of great skills and talents. Maybe I'll embarrass him a little bit. And we were out trying to get tacos, and it was delicious, by the way. And this like random person like walked up and he's like, "Sorry to interrupt, but are you Christian Peter?" You know, and he's like, "Yeah, yeah." It's like, "This guy's a legend." And I was like, "Yeah, he is." So I'm just really stoked. He brings a lot of really cool talents to our team, a lot of expertise, and I feel like our team or like our party sort of leveled up here. So happy to have him.
Yeah, most definitely. No, I appreciate that. And yeah, echo all of it. And also jealous about the tacos. But I get to get tacos on Saturday with KP. So I'm following in Fox's footsteps, which does remind me, actually, since we're here anyway, Saturday, Carlsbad, California, 5 p.m. Draft Republic, or is it Draft Republic, Christian? Is that the right name? I think it is.
Yeah, that's the right place. So if you guys are in SoCal or anywhere close on Saturday, come meet Bolon, hang out with us for the day. It's going to be so much fun. I'm buying beers. It'll be great.
Yeah, really looking forward to that. It's going to be a lot of fun. Definitely come out and join us if you're able to. So I'm glad that reminded me of that plug. So on to some questions. The first one is going to be for the Dude of Beetle, and it's not even adding something to your list this time. Regarding the, I don't know if you know what to do with this, to be perfectly honest. I don't think we've practiced this. Regarding the sign-in functionality for CTG and hunts, first part of the question is, why are there two steps?
I'll just add it to the list, Bolon, it's fine. I'll add the answer to the list. No, that's a great question. So it's specifically for security purposes. The original signature is essentially to verify that it is your wallet, which creates a random nonce in the database. And the second transaction is verifying that the nonce matches what's in the database and also that you own the wallet. Essentially, it is ensuring that that it's not susceptible to replay attacks. If someone were able to get the original signature, the random nonce ensures that it's you and that you've recently created the new nonce and that it matches what's in the database. For security purposes, that's how we handle it with MetaMask. We could have gone with a single signature transaction, but that opens up some security vulnerabilities that we wanted to avoid. And I will put in a plug for the Holiday Wallet, that if you use the Holiday Wallet, it will sign you in automatically without you having to do anything additional, which is awesome and a great plug for that functionality in that version of the wallet. So hopefully that makes sense. It's definitely just to make sure that we're making sure that the people that are signed in are the right people and that they have access to the wallet and keeping your data and your hunt safe. But check out Paladay if you haven't.
Awesome. Yeah, do genuinely recommend checking out Holiday if you haven't. There's a lot of really good quality of life stuff and more coming as well. Second part on the sign in. It seems I have to sign in every day, even without closing my browser or clearing my cache. Does it expire daily, or is that triggered by switching to another wallet or chain or something similar to that?
Yes, great question. It won't log you out if you switch chains. It will log you out if you change wallets or if you switch from mainnet to testnet. Essentially, to avoid having you logged in on mainnet on your testnet account or logged in on one wallet when you're using a different wallet. It's essentially just to make sure that there's no cross-contamination between the wallet that's currently selected and the one that you're attempting to use, because that'll result in some definite weirdness when you're trying to queue up battles or combat testing sessions. So yeah, those are the main reasons that you might get logged out. I believe it maintains in the browser for quite a bit of time as long as you don't do any of those things. it should keep you logged in for the most part unless you're switching accounts.
Yep, makes sense from the security side. I can say as somebody who doesn't switch accounts, and it keeps me logged in for a while. I couldn't tell you how long, but it's definitely more than a day. But yeah, from the security side, makes sense to make sure it's pulling from the right place. Let's see. So question on expeditions. Will expeditions have a maximum length at which, if you've not collected your heroes, they stop accruing loot / questing? If not, how do we plan on handling potentially very large transactions for completing expeditions?
Yep, I can take this one since Hubert's away. So basically, the design will be the ability to batch transactions so you can let your expedition go pretty much as long as you like. You can claim a certain number of rewards, and then you'll do the next batch. And then with that design, we're not limited by the amount of gas you can fit in one transaction. So it'll be a little more flexible than the current questing system in that regard.
Very nice, very nice. Question on boar hunts / combat in general. Thoughts of having a like high speed version that speeds up animations?
Yeah, that's a great question. We have had talks internally about that being an option. It may get a little complicated, and there's quite a bit that it would affect, so it would be a little bit of a bigger lift. But I will, I guess, put in a plug for just the fact that we're doing our best to increase the speed of as many animations as we can, just in general. With the most recent release of Warrior, we actually sped up a few of the biggest offenders, which were like Bleed and Recovery, and we're going to just keep doing what we can to increase the speed there and make sure that we're, you know, maximizing time, making it as efficient as possible. So probably in the short term, we'll be looking at just continuing to optimize animations, and then in the long term, look at adding a speed increase option as well.
Nice. Yeah, I think that's an important reminder as well that, you know, all of the timing is stuff that we're also, you know, adjusting and working on even prior. So, you know, having like a fast mode necessarily, you know, may not make sense until we have timing at least where we want it to be first, so that we can have a better idea of where it stands currently. So,
yep.
All right. Another Beetle question. It's Beetle hour today, boys. They heard Hubert was out and just loaded down for you. Thoughts on having an NPC that links to equipment sales in the marketplace, Which I'll also add, I think the tavern could be a good option as well, either one.
Yeah, yeah, that's a fair point. Yeah, we talked about this a little bit, that, you know, all the other functions that have similar behavior are attached to NPCs. It is nice to kind of have a shortcut just through the equipment menu, but I think it would also make sense to have it be an option on the one of the zones. And I do love making SBD create NPCs, and it's one of his favorite things to do. So I don't think it would be out of the question to get that in the works. I think for consistency's sake, it makes sense, and I can add it to SBD's list and not mine. So I like the sound of that.
Always nice to put it on somebody else's list, right? another equipment-based question. Since at some point we will sell equipment with or without 100% of its durability, will we have a notification for that in place from the start so that we are warned about things like that prior to purchase?
All right, I'm speaking as a Hubert here, so I might not have the full picture, but my understanding is that we, at the very... Yes. Oops. Sorry, Hubert, if I mess this up. But yeah, my understanding is that the idea would be, at the very least, that the primary default that you'd see when purchasing equipment would be of only pristine equipment that hasn't lost any durability. I think there's still some question marks about what that would mean for equipment that has diminished durability and where that would live and whether that would be sellable or not. But that, I think that's still a question mark, but as far as like visibility, we definitely identified that as a big concern, and one that we want to make sure people are aware of the durability that they're purchasing when they go in to do that. So yep,
awesome, thank you for the insight there, Hubert 2.0. Does the team plan to work on presence in Stars Arena? I mean, I'll take that one. Yes would be the short answer. I actually got signed back in and have done a post or two so far. It is something that I do want to ramp up again. I really like their platform. I think it has a lot of promise. But they've also had some challenges, and so, you know, trying to make sure that we let them kind of get stable a little bit again before we put too many resources into it. But yes, I really like their platform. I think it's got a lot of promise. It's somewhere that, you know, we want to be seen and known. So I do think you will continue, pending any outside impacts, you will see us continue to step up in the arena in the coming days and weeks. So looking forward to that. It is a pretty cool place. Let's see. So there's a question. There's a tweet sent by the Ava Labs team. I want to say it was Patrick, but I might be wrong, so don't hold me to that. But kind of like their personal vision of the division of chains with, you know, C chain and X chain and subnets. So the question is, like, as far as like Hyper-VM subnets and kind of their vision on how the chains, you know, work together but also split out, thoughts from our team on kind of how we interpret that and what our thoughts on our approach or our thoughts are on our approach to that.
So I can speak to the Hyper-VM piece. Yeah, Ava Labs has been doing a ton of work on Hyper-VM. They've kind of like ripped out a lot of the things that were slowing the EVM down, and have been just building like crazy. I mean, Patrick's pushing PRs all the time, so very impressed with what they've got going on over there. It's boasting some pretty impressive numbers, and I know a lot of those aren't final, but definitely is making the blockchain space move forward quite a bit, because they're building both Avalanche as well as the subnet EVM and Hyper-VM. I think we'll see a lot of cross-pollination there, particularly around the database technology making its way back, and some of the more creative, like the ability to charge opcodes differently than the EVM, which lets you optimize for different things as a subnet operator. So while things are kind of in flux and there's kind of like a lot of public discussion around what the best path for all those chains are, I'll say just generally the future is very bright there, and there's a lot of technology we could leverage, but whether it's staying kind of in the EVM world and being the recipient of those benefits on our subnet on DFK chain, or potentially some of the Rust and WebAssembly based technologies with Hyper-VM that they're blazing a path forward on. We may be able to leverage some of that technology as well. But we'll definitely be updating everyone as we see how that develops. But very exciting future.
Yeah, one thing that you can always count on with Ava Labs is that they are pushing the bounds as well, and always working on some really cool stuff. And we're always excited to be able to take advantage of that and grow with them. Let's see. This might be a Beetle Dude question. The flame in the Crystal Veil marketplace. Is there a reason why it changes color, and is there any lore behind it?
There is a little bit of lore behind it. I don't know if there's anything specifically about the color changing. I think there are some ideas still floating around how we might use that, possibly having some daily benefits based on the color. But I guess it's just a general explanation of the fire. It is the sacred flame. It is the essence of Skali, and it courses through the roots of Skadrasel. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. It emits a large flame, like in the marketplace. Sometimes many different colors. Its primary color is blue. The properties don't change based on the different color of the flames. And in general, it's a pretty cool flame. It's used to do things like bring the Ents to life, provide some warmth and vitality to the citizens of Vithraven. And I'm sure we'll expand on it as time goes by as well. But yes, that is the base, at least.
Nice. Very much appreciated. One for Dreamer. So a few weeks back, we kind of gave an update a little bit on centralized exchanges. You were then on Christian Peters' podcast. He's here now. Kind of elaborated a little bit more on it. I think you did answer this one in chat as well, if anybody wants to go see the written answer. But just curious if you wanted to expound on that while we're here.
Sure. So, everything that we do tends to adjust with new information that we get. When we first started looking into centralized exchanges, the information then was everybody was mad that we even were considering it. I got like totally roasted on Twitter. We had an opportunity to look into some major exchanges and everybody's like, don't do it. So at that point, the sentiment was totally different. People didn't want like an easy exit, I assume, at the time. I personally was concerned with perps, like perpetual contracts, like futures being added to Joule at that time because of just too much leverage, too much synthetic security-like offerings entering the space too quickly without people understanding it. It was just a recipe for disaster. One of the largest exchanges that was leading with perps had things happen that we all know that we don't have to talk about here. Moving into the bear market and the changes there, I think our focus was, how do we survive what happened on the chain that shall not be named? How do we find a new home for Serendale? How do we build the game? How do we stabilize and continue to put out content with very minimal budget? And we solved all that earlier this year. Well, we have been doing our best to solve that on an ongoing basis, and I've been doing a good job, if we look at everything that we put out. But not solved, still working constantly on that and the future. Earlier this year, though, we looked at it and we're like, we're in the middle of the bear market. We need to figure out how to get on a centralized exchange. It would be really great if we could hit a US-based tier one, tier two exchange. Let's do some work. Sunbear, myself, Zipper, Bolon, a lot of others contributed to this effort. And we talked to, I don't know, double-digit number of exchanges just to learn what's required, what's it looking like now. And we learned a lot. One is that you need a market maker. So we went out and had a deal ready to sign with a tier one market maker. Check. It's going to cost money, and it's going to be interesting to make that work. But there are different options out there. We found one that at the time could work for us. Then we're looking at various exchanges. Now, I don't know if people realize how many hoops you have to jump through to get on some of these exchanges. A lot of the time, it's driven by moolah. A lot of moolah. You know, 100K, 200K, 400K listing fees. Those are Ks that we do not have ready to just throw at a listing. But we were looking for exchanges that were willing to work with us. And amid all of that, with our luck and timing, as it usually goes, you know, CFTC going after Binance and SEC going after Coinbase. We took a step back and we said, advised by our market maker and our lawyers, you know, be cautious of the US listing right now. We don't know what we don't know. Let's let this thing pan out. So we've been kind of sitting on the sidelines. Now, in the last couple of weeks, things are shifting a bit. We got a lot of exciting news out there with various ETFs, regulation updates, lawsuit updates, and just general market movement. And there have been folks in the community and internally and partners all, you know, adjusting. We got new information. Let's reassess the strategy. One of our core partners, Klaytn, they've been focused heavily on Japan. Japan is our number two largest user base in terms of geographic breakdown. And our product would do very well in that market. It's a market that we wanted to tap into, but it's hard to tap into. Klaytn is working on various listings there, and they're making introductions to local centralized exchanges in Japan. This is an area that operates very differently. They tend to not have listing fees. They focus on how long you've been around and your overall network and your product. So not how much volume they can spike initially, not the listing fees that they're going to cash out with and move on to the next. I'm not trying to talk poorly about other exchanges, but this is kind of how it goes. So that is of interest. We've already met with the first one there and are going to continue to explore that. It's really good user acquisition strategy, not only a listing for Jewel, but more exposure in an area that we want to be exposed to and isn't in the scope of the U.S. regulatory eyes that others are. We have a few others that we've been looking at. You know, interestingly enough, some exchanges, they may not require listing fees, but they look at your Twitter following and they look at your average impressions. So there's one exchange in particular that requires at least 20,000 average impressions to list you. Very interesting. They never had heard of that, but they are a top 10 exchange. And so... I want people to understand all that goes into this. You know, there was a poll, where should we list? We choose Binance. Oh man, it'd be great to be listed on Binance Global. Binance Global has a lot of other entities that you have to kind of step into. We were in talks with Binance US, and as I said, things changed. They're looking to shut down or get bought out, and kind of, I don't know if turmoil is the right word, but there was a time when everybody was telling us to list on FTX, and I was personally very hesitant there with the perpetual contracts as mentioned, and you know, we need to look at the long-term view and see what is good for us, what is stable, what is good opportunity that has more than just a bump in price as the goal. Our goal is not necessarily price. It's access to our tokens. It is exposure. It's user acquisition. So in the coming weeks and months, hopefully we will provide updates on efforts in that direction. But the tier one, tier two goal of US-based listing is no longer in focus. We took time in our tokenomics meeting this week to talk about what is our new focus. It is looking at our target area, which is really Asia, and looking at non-US exchanges that are willing to work with us on listing fees and make it work on the cost of market making. And let's start building, maybe from mid-tier, tier three exchanges. But let's start building in those that'll market with us and are strategic. So we ask the community to understand, we hear you, we agree with you, we want to be on centralized exchanges when all of these factors I have summarized are considered, and we're going to try to make progress there. If there's ever an exchange that we aren't making progress on that we really want to be, there's likely a financial restraint or some blocker that we're working through, or a lot of exchanges like KuCoin, they're not even doing listings right now. They're taking a huge step back and reassessing some other things. So it isn't always just a choice, yes, no. Willingness and ability are two different things. We are now more willing, and there will be exchanges where we are not able and others that we are, and we're going to do our best to navigate that in the coming months.
Incredibly well said, sir. Right, let's see. Completely changing gears here for the next one. Let's see. So how much money does the team plan to spend on marketing in the next 12 months? I mean, I'll just say first, and then anybody's welcome to weigh in. That's an incredibly complicated question to even try to answer. You know, so much can change in 12 months, as we have seen live and in person. So, you know, trying to predict something out over the next 12 months is near impossible to pull off. I will say, in general, we've, you know, said it before, right now, you know, we're really focused on maximizing our budget to survive and build and continue building. And, you know, careful about any funds that we spend on marketing at the moment. But as far as like the next 12 months go, you know, there's just so many variables there that can very easily change. And as things improve, we'll probably see different answers to that question. But as of now, it's hard to say what'll happen over the next 12 months. Anybody have anything they want to add to that?
Yeah, I can add to that. So I think this question could be answered a few different ways. I think it's asking, about money, and spending things on ads, and events and parties and other things. We've never been a big spender in that area, but are trying to build expertise. And that's why, you know, Workhorse and KP, they both have a really unique skill sets and exposure to various ways to market. We're marketing on a budget. That means, you know, resources in marketing have been turned up, not necessarily on the money side. But if you notice, we've been more active in socials. This isn't something I'm good at. I've been trying to do more there, and others are as well. We have always been focused on co-marketing with partners, and Sundar and Zipper, Bull, and others have been really good at that. We got some things cooking up that could improve that. We hopped on a reality show that we hoped would be a little bit better distributed and produced, and we're happy with what we got. But if you look at our strides in marketing in the last 12 months, we've been doing a lot to do more with what we have. The question is, can we spend more? We really can't currently. We feel like over-marketing, and I'll use the word underdeveloped. It just means that this is a long roadmap, but like a game in development that is over-marketed prematurely, where that money could have gone into building. And if marketing makes it so that we cannot build it, it's kind of a chicken and egg scenario, right? You want to find the balance there where you can spend on marketing without slowing down or limiting the actual build of the product. It's kind of different. A lot of people in Web3, they overmarket, overhype, and then they may or may not deliver at any point. We're trying to deliver as consistent as we can with the resources we got. We'll keep working on marketing in a shifted market, in a different treasury scenario. This would be a better question to answer. So I invite people to ask it as we see things improve and as we see users go up and fees in the game go up and in turn, you know, people's ROI in the jeweler go up. And as all of that happens, and if there is price appreciation and other things, we should ask, you know, what else we're going to do with that incremental ability. We don't have the incremental ability now, so we're going to try to keep doing more with what we got. And if you have ideas on how we can do that and increase margin, marketing exposure, co-marketing partnerships on a budget, we'd love to hear it.
Yeah, for sure. Oh, go ahead, Sundar.
Oh, I'm just going to add to that. You know, there's a theme that I don't know if a lot of people are aware of that's within this team. It's within kind of our philosophy of how we engage our partners, even how we engage with our community members. And that theme is really like finding people that are willing to, in a very like-minded way, like invest in us, that allow us to invest in them, and that aren't looking for something that isn't like long-term, you know, dedicated quality. When you think about the folks that have joined this team along the way, or even like the people who are on this team right now working full-time, and really like making a lot of sacrifices to make this project happen. Or the conversations when we're in negotiation with partnerships that are saying, hey, if you want us to build this for, it's going to take, you know, $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 to do that. And then we talk through how we can invest in each other, and they end up doing it for us for free because they see the potential and we lift them up as a partner. There's a theme there of lifting people up. And that's really what we're doing with marketing too. Marketing is a part of every conversation with every partner, every influencer. Like, we're getting out there to really help people see what this is. And as they learn about it, they see the potential and they see the future of it. And I mean, the reality is we're a game that's going to take years to build, and people who see that vision and what it is, they're jumping on board. And I think the market's ready for us to do that. Anyway, just wanted to name that theme because it's part of what keeps me here, is the belief in it. And I just love working with the partners that we are bringing in because they're right there with us and believe in it as well. So.
For sure. And also, oh, good.
Oh, maybe I'm going to say the same thing, but I gave a shout out in chat, but also want to do it verbally as well, just because I don't think Sunbear gets a ton of kudos, but big kudos to him. He does an awesome job getting out there and making sure, like you said, that our partners are aware of what we're doing and getting those deals made. Strider as well are just working in the background, making moves and getting us exposure wherever possible. So kudos to them. They're doing a great job and not as visible as the rest of us building, but doing awesome work.
Yeah. And also just to add to that, a shout out to both of them for, you know, y'all have seen the announcements of partnering with game launchers and that kind of thing. You know, that's their hard work. And those are opportunities that we have to get in front of people who are already playing games, but they might not be playing ours. So stuff like that as well is, you know, definitely a big impact and something that Sunbear and Strider in particular are really behind, are really driving. And it's a great opportunity. Outside of that, and, you know, Dreamer kind of implied this anyway, but, you know, stuff like our Twitter presence, you know, even moving our AMAs to Twitter spaces, that kind of thing. Like, those are things that, you know, are within our control that we can do to try to, you know, really step up our game. You know, we had been a little bit quiet for a bit and, you know, really focused on building. And, you know, as general sentiment of, you know, the overall environment turns around, it's time to make some noise. And that, excuse me, that time is approaching. So I'm looking forward to making some noise because it's fun and I'm a very loud person. So, but yeah, I think we'll continue to see things evolve there. The follow-up question to that was, what do members of the team consider the most important aspects regarding recruiting new players? I'm going to kick this one off again, but again, anyone's welcome to chime in as well. You know, I've talked about this before and I won't stop talking about it, but you know, I'm a huge, massive believer in organic growth, and our community, you guys, everyone listening to this, everyone playing our game right now are the absolute best marketing tool that we have, because we're going to go out there and talk about how great DFK is. But you know what everybody expects is for DFK to say how great DFK is, because it'd be weird if we didn't. But when all of you come in and also talk about how great DFK is, you know, when Alex Becker sends a tweet about Avalanche and we've been tagged in it, I don't even know how many times. At one point I tried to keep count and then I gave up. You know, that is so impactful that it cannot be measured. And I really think, like, you know, that was so much of our growth when we launched was the same thing. It was, you know, organic word of mouth, people who believed in the project, talking about the project to other people. And that's something that can't be replaced. You know, no advertising is the same as people who genuinely believe in something that they are participating in, telling other people about it. That is the absolute best marketing you can possibly ask for, in my opinion. So that's, to me, that is the most important aspect regarding recruiting new players, is all of you, our current players. You know, the fact that I can go on Twitter on the DFK account and somebody says, hey, you know, this looks kind of cool, how do I learn more? And I can give them some information and I can tell them, hey, if you join our Discord, every question you have will be answered by our community. Like, it doesn't matter if I'm online, if our mods are online, it doesn't matter. If you hop in our Discord and ask a question, you will be answered by our community because we have the best community in this space. That's impactful. And, you know, we've been seeing that. We've been seeing people coming back to our Discord who say, hey, I haven't been here in over a year. What's going on? And just all of you stepping in to help them, to show them what's changed, to help them get caught up. Like, that is so impactful, and I really appreciate all of you. But yeah, I'll stop talking now. Anybody else want to chime in on what they think the most important aspect of recruitment is?
I just wanted to second that, Bolan. I think that the DFK community is second to none. And, you know, the community, the content creators that are out there that are making amazing content on YouTube, on Twitter, on everything, on Twitch, you know, there's so many people making so many really cool things. And it just is, it speaks volumes for the community that we have, the family that's, you know, been brought up through the you know, the roller coaster ride that we've all been on. And now that we're, you know, miking our way through this, it's just it's a question of going out there and supporting everyone and looking for those little content creators. I was out last night and I saw several that I had never seen before. And I dropped comments and likes and shared the videos. And I think that everybody going out there and doing that and just looking for those DFK comments, like you said, Alex Becker's Twitter blew up with DFK comments. And there's just so many opportunities to go out there and share the word. And it's just the people that are here that are loving this, that want it to grow. You know, you guys can all smash the like buttons. You guys can all leave comments. It just helps the YouTube algorithms. I think that Pi left a comment in the voiceless chat about how the Twitter algorithm works. Those things just are huge, and they just do a ton of, you know, really good support for everything that we're growing, everything that we're building. And it's just all about growth right now, guys. The more that you can get out there and do, the better. I'll leave it back to you.
For sure. Really appreciate that, KP. And again, just excited to have you here to flow into all of that as well. Let's see. So one other question kind of in the same vein, and Sunbear actually kind of referenced this a little bit himself as well. How many team members are currently working on DFK full time? Dreamer, you want to take that one?
Sure thing. So I don't know if the core question here is how many or the full time, but I would say, you know, everybody that you see working, they're putting in full time effort, but they're also making like part time sacrifices. Since a year and a half ago, the team that you've seen been building have been doing it for their own reasons, and those reasons are many, but very few, if any, of those are on the money side. There's huge sacrifices here. We're here because we love the vision, we love the game, we love the ecosystem, we love the community. And I think it would be unfair to say that anybody really isn't putting in full-time effort. But I'd also want to be transparent that, you know, there are financial sacrifices that everybody's making. The number of people working, I think the team now is 20 plus or so that I would say is that full-time effort. We do have a number of part-time effort people, but that's kind of by design. You know, like Sam, we love Sam. We love his music. He's doing a lot of different things. We don't always have music for him to work on. But when we do, man, he hops up, knocks it out of the park, and keeps going. So that's one example of when he's on, he's full-time on. We always have front end. We always have animations. We always have art. We always have marketing. We always have tokenomics, strategy, community going. So I'd say any of these guys that you see, man, they're really putting in that full-time effort. But that number, I believe, would be in that like 20 or so range. But I just want to not misrepresent here. There are sacrifices being made in terms of like a full-time, you know, salary or anything of the equivalent. None of us are really there where it's we're getting paid our dream salary to be doing this. All of us are here because we want to make this thing incredible. We want to continue to take over and innovate the space and to welcome so many into it. So that's about as transparent as I think we can be, which I hope people appreciate.
Here for the love of the project, without a doubt. All right, I'm going to snag one last question and then we will pause for today. Basic idea for a marketing system would need refinement by I'm reading their words, I'm not saying that, but so having like a referral code or invite link that players could share have their friends sign up through their link, and then they would receive a portion of the in-game fees that the players on the other end of those links generate. So, you know, potentially changing some of the burn to instead be like a referral bonus kind of thing. So open to any thoughts there. I'll just say, you know, one thing to keep in mind is how easily gamed something can be. This is one that could definitely be gamed. That does not necessarily mean that it is a bad idea and it can't be worked around and whatnot. But that's just, you know, especially when everything has financial impact. So, you know, if you think about a traditional game, you say, okay, refer players and we'll give you, you know, this in-game stuff. Well, that in-game stuff doesn't cost anything. It doesn't have value. It doesn't, you know, do anything. It just enhances your game experience. In Web3, everything has value. So, you know, when we talk about doing like a share of in-game transactions, you know, that is financial value that's being rewarded. That is a positive also, but you have to make sure that it's not, you know, overly abusable as well when you're doing those factors. So other than that, Fox, I think you had some thoughts on this. Anyone else is welcome to chime in as well.
Trying to find the unmute button, but yeah, I mean, we actually considered this very, very early on in the project. And there's a lot of really cool things that can come about from those types of marketing efforts. We're actually factoring some of this into another project we're working on. So, I mean, not exactly how it was there, but just ideas in that realm. And I think that they're good ideas, and I think that there's a potential that we do implement some of them. But, you know, it's just a matter of when is the perfect time for that, and what do we have on our plates, what are we doing? So, yeah, I'll just say that I think what I want to do is I want to actually maybe queue this up for a little bit of a discussion in our tokenomics committee this coming week. Just see what other people think, because there is a possibility that we find a good place for that to fit. It probably wouldn't be something that fits everywhere for all of our features, but it might be like really cool for certain ones that we do.
Yeah, makes sense. Anybody else want to chime in there before we go into wrap up? All right. So we will wrap up for the week, as I said earlier, but for anybody that missed it, next week, next Thursday is Thanksgiving in the US, so we will not be doing an AMA on Thursday, that much I can pretty confidently say. We're going to figure out if we want to slide to a different day or just postpone from next week to the following week. We will follow up with more details there, but do expect for our next AMA to be a Twitter space or X space or SpaceX, I don't know what they're called anymore, but we are going to be giving that a shot, so do prepare for that. We are still planning on streaming it over to YouTube as well from there, as well as using the AMA voiceless chat still as our main hub of conversation, although Twitter space does have, like, you can tweet, like, under the space. So that is available, and we'll probably do some of that as well. But the way that we have kind of the free-flowing conversation that we all love and enjoy and often get distracted by is not as effective on Twitter, and we don't want to necessarily give that up either. So this is something that we're going to be trying out. Ask for you to bear with us a little bit as we do it for the first couple times. But really looking forward to that. Don't ape into broken mechanics. I think those are all of my reminders. Any final thoughts from anybody? And then I think Christian has to give us a bullish today. But any final thoughts from anybody else before we turn over to Christian? All right. Seems like everybody just wants to hear from you, KP.
Well, cool. I get to finish this off with a huge bullish!
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 Thanks, guys.
Thank you, everybody. Christian. We'll see you next week. Potentially.